Welcome back to the 8th video in the switch mode power supply repair series as done by the donkey himself. In today's video we will study the basic concepts of pulse width modulation in electric power circuits. In the previous video we have looked at this simple technique of passing the power going to a lamp using a mechanical switch. We have concluded that this is a lot more efficient technique since there is no power being constantly wasted on a series element. Namely, in a linear power supply we always dissipate a considerable amount of power in form of heat in order to limit the power being delivered to the consumer. This is because we turn the power which is not needed by the consumer to heat on the series element. So in practice we just regulate the power delivered to the consumer by adjusting the amount of power which we will turn into heat. Although this is a really simple strategy, it is also highly inefficient. Now the consumer in these examples so far is a simple lamp. And this is because I would like to keep the examples as simple as possible. However, as I will show you in the future videos, for inductive loads, like coils, transformers and motors and such, one need to take into account the effect of magnetic saturation. This makes the design and repair considerably more complex, so for the time, magnetic saturation will be completely neglected. Regarding magnetic saturation, in my video series I have already discussed the magnetic core materials in switch mode power supplies, so eventually please watch that video first. Now in contrast to linear power supplies, pulsing is a technique of all or nothing. Because for a fraction of a time, the full power flows through the circuit when we close this switch. After we open this switch for a short time, there is absolutely no power going through this circuit. So the main idea is that we can adjust the average power, and I have to emphasize this, the average power flowing through the filament of the lamp by turning the switch on and off in a quick succession. We can use the pulsing technique since there is a small delay in the rise and fall of the temperature of the filament. In today's episode we will extend the pulsing technique and we will look into the concept of pulse width modulation. In particular, we're gonna look at various properties of a pulse width modulation signal which will help us out to interpret the datasheet of different pulse width modulation controller integrated circuits. Also, this way you will get a better feeling of what you see on an oscilloscope when you are trying to repair a switch mode power supply. In the last video we have seen that when we use the pulsing technique we must use a really high switching frequency. Namely, as you remember, when I was toggling the switch with my fingers, one could clearly notice that the lamp was obviously blinking instead of providing a continuous light. The switching frequency tells us how frequently we are toggling the switch on and off. In a pulse width modulation circuit, we call this frequency the switching frequency. In order to have a better understanding of the frequency and of a switching period, we have covered the basic properties of periodic functions in video number 7. In order to have easy math and nice round numbers, in today's video we will use an example of 1 kHz as the switching frequency. However, I have to clearly point out to you that in real-life applications, most pulse width modulation signals used in switch mode power supplies will start at a range of around 20,000 or 20 kHz. The reason for this is that when we go up in the switching frequency, we can use smaller transformers. This makes the power supply smaller and lighter. Furthermore, above this 20 kHz, most people will not be able to hear anymore the so-called coil whine, which is a typical mechanical noise emitted by a switch mode power supply unit. In the previous video we introduced the concept of periodic functions and the duration of a period. So now this 1 kHz switching frequency in our current example means that the switching signal will have a time period of 1 millisecond. Of course, since in real power supplies we use a lot higher frequencies, In those real cases, the period will be only about 15 microseconds or even lower. What we need to ask at this stage is the following. Does the frequency give us another useful information? Well, the short answer is not really, because the frequency only tells us that if we toggle the switch, we need to open and close it within an interval of 1 millisecond, which is the time interval of a period in the frequency of a kilohertz signal. This means that the switching frequency alone as an information is not telling us how long we will turn on the switch or how long we will release the switch within this time period of 1 millisecond. Therefore, in addition to the period or the frequency, if you wish, we are just converting the two between each other. So anyway, in addition to the period, we must know some additional parameters which are then describing to us how long we press down the switch or how long we release the switch within this amount of time interval. Here we are back at the figure showing the 1 millisecond period of a 1 kHz signal. Now in addition to the period, here we can see that the signal is characterized by an on time and an off time. The on time is the amount of time within a period when the switch is on, whereas the off time is the amount of time when the switch is turned off. One period is the sum of the on time and the off time. Just as a reminder, so far we have looked at a mechanical switch where we always discuss that if the switch is then being pressed down, then the switch is on and there is power flowing through the circuit. Whereas if the switch is then up or released, then there is no power going through the circuit. In contrast to the picture of the mechanical switch, where a down state means turning the switch on, and the up state was showing when the switch is off, engineers use the opposite notation when it comes to pulse width modulation signals. Namely, when the signal is up, what is being called in technical terms that the signal is high, the switching element is being turned on. And when the signal goes low, that is when we turn off the switching element. Well, I would say this is because, you know, engineers were developing pulse width modulation technique in the 60s. They were kind of free spirits, so probably they preferred when the signal goes high. I'm just joking, of course. I mean, they had no inspiration from Tolly from South Park. So anyway, the real reason is that in electronic engineering, we display the logical state of a switch instead of its physical position. A logically true or high state means that the switch is on, whereas when the switch goes to a logically low or false state, then the switch is off. So if we would connect a oscilloscope to the output pin of a pulse width modulation controller chip, we would see a signal which is somewhat similar to this, where when the signal then goes to a logically high state, that is when the chip tells the switching element, most of the time a field effect transistor, that it has to turn on, and after a while, the pulse width modulation controller chip will tell our FET or field effect transistor that now it should turn off, so that's why the signal goes low, and for an amount of time period, our switching element will be turned off. After a while, this whole process repeats over and over again, since this is a periodic function. After clarifying this, before we look into the pulse width modulation, first we have to check actually what is the pulse width itself. As a relatively easy and hand-waving introduction to the so-called rise time and fall time in pulse width modulation signals, first we're gonna look at what happens when we have just a simple mechanical switch. So imagine now in your mind what happens when we press down the switch in slow motion. As you can imagine, the switch here, the contacts are not perfectly round. There is always some small metal spikes which are sticking out of the contacts. In addition to this, there is also a mechanical spring, because you can clearly hear this clanking noise when you close the switch or when you open a light switch as an example. The effect of these two components is the following. When we are closing the switch, there will be always a time period when the switch is neither fully closed or nor fully open, so it just barely makes contact here. Similarly, when the switch is fully closed and we start to open up the switch to open the circuit, as you can imagine, there will be again a short period of time when this switch here is not fully closed, but it is also not fully opened as of yet. For mechanical switches, there is an additional phenomena called debouncing. In the current video, we're gonna completely neglect this debouncing phenomena because it's not really important for the current video. In switch mode power supplies, we are using a switching element, so-called electronically controlled switches, so not mechanical switches like what I have just showed you previously, but instead switches like bipolar transistors or insulated gate bipolar transistors, which are short IGBTs, or field effect transistors. These transistors here, whatever type of transistor they are serving the purpose of a switching element. Although these switching elements here are not mechanical switches, still, due to the physics of semiconductors and also due to some quantum phenomena in the semiconductor material, they will be also not able to fully turn on or fully turn off. So let us assume that we have here this pulse width modulation controller chip, which is sending the signal for the transistor to turn on. Now, here you can see that it directly turns on instantaneously. However, in reality, we know that due to these phenomena of the semiconductor materials, there will be a small delay when this transistor is not fully on yet, but is just partially on. After a while, it will be then fully on, then it stays in the fully on state, and then when the pulse width modulation controller chip sends the signal, okay, now it's time to turn off, then also the transistor will not instantaneously turn off, but there will be a small period of time when this transistor is partially still on. And now the question is then, what is the implication of this effect? When we look at the pulse width modulation signal on a diagram, due to this switching delay, the signal will not instantaneously jump from 0 to 1 or from the low to the high state, and also it will not be able to instantly drop from the high state to the low state. Instead, there will be this short amount of time called the rise time, during which the switch is partially turned on until it reaches the state when it is then fully on. Similarly, there is a so-called fall time, which is a short time needed for the switch to fall from a fully on state to a fully off state. The pulse width itself is that portion of the on time when the switch is fully and completely turned on. In engineering terms, it is referred as the switching element is being hard fully on. Seriously, that is how it is called. I'm not talking about anything naughty here. You can look it up on Wikipedia. For a simple mechanical switch, the hard fully on state would be equivalent to the state when the switch contacts are then fully settled and then the switch is fully on. Coming back to our signal diagram here, this means that the on time here, as you can see, is comprised by the rise time, then the pulse width, and then also of the fall time. Compared to mechanical switches, transistors can turn on and off a lot faster, and this means that the rise and fall time is a lot shorter compared to mechanical switches, and we are talking about several order of magnitude faster here. When we are dealing with relatively low frequency switch mode power supplies, so let us assume in order of 20 to about 50 kHz or so, then we can do a really rough approximation when we can say that the transistor as a switching element is so fast that we're gonna send it a signal to turn on, and the transistor will almost instantaneously will turn on fully. And when we send it a signal to turn off, then it will almost instantaneously turn off. As an implication of this approximation, we can then say that the pulse width is approximately or more or less equal to the on time. After we have talked about the concept of the pulse width itself, now we can go back to the original problem what we tried to tackle. Namely, our goal was that we wanted this lamp to put out only half of the light output compared to the case when it is always fully connected to this battery here. And now the question is, how can we actually achieve this with the pulsing technique? And well, the solution is really simple. We just need to turn on and off the switch in a quick succession, and then we need to make sure that for half of the time we then turn on the switch, as you can see here on this diagram, and then half of the period then we turn off the switch. So in average, then we will have 50% of the power flowing through the lamp. So if we would connect an oscilloscope and we would monitor what is going on, then we know that here the switching period is then defined by the switching frequency. So in our example, we used a switching frequency of 1 kHz. So here this would be 1 millisecond here this period. Then what we would see on the oscilloscope screen is that at the beginning, let us assume that we start with a switching element which is fully turned off. Then the switching element is then being almost turned fully on. So this is then shown here by the value of 1 or fully true. Then the switching element stays for about 50% or half of the period in the on state. Then we suddenly turn it off and the switching element almost instantaneously turns off. And for half of the period, the switching element stays being turned off. After the end of one of these periods, we just play the same game over and over again. So we just repeat the same signal because this is a periodic function. So now my question to you is the following. How would we make the lamp emit only 1/4 of the light output based on the previous discussion? As usual in electronics, the simple and nice solutions are the best solutions. So what we can do is really simple. We're just gonna use a signal when the switching element is being turned on for only 1/4 or 25% of the time, and then 3/4 or 75% of the time of the switching period, then our switching element is being fully turned off. So this way, the average power is 1/4 of the amount of full power which could flow through the circuit. So now it is easy to see that by increasing the on time of our switching element, we will increase the average power flowing through the circuit. And in contrary, when we reduce the on time of the switching element, we also reduce the average power. Since we can play around gradually with the on time and the off time, then we have to discuss some extreme cases. We have already mentioned today that the period is the sum of the on time and the off time. As an implication of this, neither the on time nor the off time can be larger than the period itself. This is equivalent to say that the on time and the off time is always smaller or equal than the period. Due to this, we could have now these two extreme scenarios here what we will discuss. First, the switch is closed for the full period of time, so the off time is zero. This would be equivalent to the case when the full power goes through the lamp. Another extreme case would be that for the full period we leave the switch open, so the off time is then the full period. This would be equivalent to the situation when the switch is always open and there is absolutely no power being delivered to the lamp. As we are approaching towards the end of today's video, we still need to introduce another important parameter in switch mode power supplies, which is being called the duty cycle, or actually the duty cycle ratio. This is a ratio between the pulse width and the period of the switching frequency, as you see here. Now, as you remember, we said that if we assume that the rise time and the fall time is approximately zero because the transistor is really, really fast, then the on time will be approximately the pulse width itself. If the on time can be approximated as the pulse width itself, since we completely neglect the rise and the fall time, this means then that we can also approximate the duty cycle ratio, where instead of the pulse width, then we again use here this on time, our approximate duty cycle ratio will become the ratio between the on time and the period of the switching frequency. In the previous slide, we already discussed the two extreme cases for the on time. So when the on time is zero, then this will result in a duty cycle of zero. When the on time is equal to period, then our duty cycle ratio will be equal to 1. So this would be the same as when the switch is always constantly on. Therefore, in a switch mode power supply, the duty cycle ratio will have values between 0 and 1, 0 corresponding to the case when the switching element is always fully open or there is absolutely no power flowing through the circuit, or the other extreme is when the duty cycle ratio is 1, which would mean that the switching element is always constantly being turned on. In most datasheets, instead of duty cycle ratio, engineers often use the duty cycle percentage instead. This is the same more or less as the duty cycle ratio, only that we multiply the value by 100 to express the value in percentages instead. Making the same approximation that the on time is equal more or less with the pulse width, then we can express the duty cycle percentage as the ratio between the on time and the period and simply just multiply this value by 100. This means that in the two extreme cases we will have a duty cycle percentage of 0 or 100%. So now the question is, what is this pulse width modulation as the mysterious technique? After today's video, it should be easy to understand it. Namely, simply by adjusting the pulse width, which is then strongly related to the on time, we can limit and stabilize and also control the average power which is flowing through a switch mode power supply circuit. A duty cycle or a pulse width of 0% means that there is no power flowing through the circuit at all, and 100% of course means full power. Now in practice, in a switch mode power supply, we're gonna be using also some sort of coils or inductors or transformers, and this means that we simply cannot go up to a duty cycle percentage of 100%, because otherwise we would reach magnetic saturation in the magnetic core, which is really no good, as I will show you in later videos. The pulse width modulation controller chip will have some form of feedback from the power transistor, and this way the pulse width modulation controller will then be able to tell the transistor when to turn on and off. This controller chip here is responsible for generating this waveform, and by modifying the pulse width, which we talked about in this video, then the pulse width modulation controller is able to control and stabilize the power going through the circuit. If you have made it so far, then many thanks for your attention. See you hopefully in video number 9, where we're gonna talk about the error amplifier and the functionality of the feedback loop